you folks as the new explorers. And I think you have a much harder task in front of you than Columbus did, or Pizarro, or some of the other explorers, Jacques Cousteau looking in the bottom of the ocean. Because you are in uncharted waters. As we bring together the European Union, we bring together a very diverse, very rich, very old cultures that are all going to be synthesized together for a common purpose. This is usually done by force. There are many models for this, the old Roman Empire. All roads lead to Rome. But that was really done by force. It was done by brute. People were not indoctrinated. They were not educated. They were not really given choices. They were told what to do, and they did it, or they died, or they lived in poverty. This is a very exciting concept, where a group of nations would come together for a common good so that they could all be better off, but still keep their own heritage, keep their own history, keep their traditions. You keep many things, but you give up many things. So the strength is within the group. Two and two isn't four, it becomes six. And it only becomes that way if people such as you are able to set the agenda, to able to bring the truth of what's going on to the common person. And that's difficult, because change is very repugnant to people. Change is shunned. We all want to keep things exactly as they are. But on the other hand, we want things to become better. So we have to go through certain stages. The first is the realization that something is going on that we might not be a part of. So the realization of an economic system that if we put all of these entities together can compete against other huge economies, the United States and Mexico and Canada, South America, the Far East, all are huge engines of monetary force. And they directly affect the lives of people all around the world. And if you're not a part of something that is competitive, that is growing, then you're going to lose out on part of the economics of the engine of the world. So it's a very exciting and very daunting situation that you're going through right now. And I think that it is so far thinking, it is so revolutionary, that it really needs strong people that know how to tell a story, that are able to go through the different stages. The EU has already decided that they need the EU. So that the realization is there. The next thing is, how is it going to happen? Well, it's already happened. Then comes acceptance. Is it going to be accepted? Well, the leaders have accepted it, but what about the individual people? How are they going to accept it? From acceptance, you have many problems, because the traditionalists don't want any part of it. The nationalists, you know, we're taking away things. You can find all kinds of different problems that are going to occur, and they can only be solved by education. They can only be solved by people having hope, because hope is what drives the human soul. And after hope, then comes love. So what we have then is a search for the model. What would be the model that could be somewhat similar to what's going on right now. You could look possibly at the United States, which is made up of people from all over the world. We have many different languages, we have cultures, we have many different religions, races. All of those have been synthesized into one country. There are many problems. How can we keep all of the strengths of the people that are coming in and still be united as one? It's difficult. We're a young country, but we've been at it for well over 100 years, and we're nowhere near there as yet. I'm in Ireland right now, so I thought the Irish really could be somewhat of a model, because as they left their country during the famine, my grandparents, friends of ours, traveled throughout the world, and they were assimilated into the populations of the countries that they immigrated into. But they became part of the country. They became part of the leadership. They kept their own identity, but they added to it. They became leaders in their particular situations. As we go into Argentina, we found that the Irish in Argentina were a great political and economic force, but they were Argentine, they weren't Irish. It's the same way in the United States. People say, I'm Irish American. They're American, but they're also Irish. So the Irish, and then in Australia, you could go throughout the world and find that. So what the problem is going to be is for people to be in the EU and say, we are Germans, we are French, we're Italians, but we're also members of the EU. And in generations to come, the love of the total will become as great as the love of the individual. So the love of being French is going to be, in future generations, the love of being part of this whole economic entity, of this whole European community. But that will not take place unless the leadership brings forward the reason to the common person. It's not being done by brute force. It's got to be done by reason. It's got to be done by education. So art is the great levelizer. We will be able to use art to show that there is a process and there is a way of using different ideas to solve the same problem, and that there's many different great honor and privilege to be here today, talk to you about things that are very important to me, not only as an artist, but as a member of the world. Any time that we can put together something that is unique and very meaningful, that's going to impact the ordinary person's life, we've really started down a road that can only lead to a much better world. And that's what you're all about. To be able to get involved in projects that will impact the lives of ordinary citizens in many, many different countries. So you are the new explorers. And we'll go on to art can be used in many different ways, because we all see things differently. We all may come to the same conclusions, but we get there in a different way. There are many paths that lead to an answer. So we don't have a cookie cutter approach. We're going to do this and this and this and this. It's always going to be the same. It isn't. Art will show that if we start with a center theme and we develop it towards whatever we think the model is going to be, each one, because we are all unique, are going to come out with a different answer. But we're all in a different road. But all the answers are going to string together into the whole, which is the solution. And we can show that through art, because we can take a thought and an idea and a word and put it onto something, a piece of paper or a canvas or wood or whatever, and be able to look at it, talk about it, discuss it. Discussion is the form of battle in today's world. If we can talk about things, then we don't have to war about things. If we can talk about things, we don't have to kill things. If we can talk about things, we can bring out possibilities. That's the stepping off of the new form of communication. There are many possibilities. And as directors, you are able to direct the minds and thoughts of the people that you attract into your houses of learning towards a better understanding of what this whole process is. And by using art, you can take an everyday occurrence where the children are playing with it, or it's Chicago. That was the Stockyards. And April 7th, 1932. Bridgeport was a very exciting, interesting part of the city of Chicago. The Blake brothers were old-time politicians and funeral directors, back in about the 1880s. They bought this particular piece of property. First they had a place at Canal Port in Jefferson, and then they went to the town of Lake, which is the present Bridgeport area, and built a funeral home there because the Columbian Exposition was going to be on the lakefront. And they wanted to have a funeral home close to where these millions of people were going to be assembling from all over the world to the exhibition. The Stockyards, Chicago was the meat capital of the world. So there was a great pungent odor that you could really, you really knew you were alive when you woke up every day. We lived right on a streetcar track. So the streetcars would go rattling by. Of course, there was no air conditioning. It was the Depression era. So nobody had any money, but nobody seemed to bother or care. Everybody worked together. It was quite an interesting time to be alive. I was just a kid, but I remembered many of the sights and sounds of that era. The Bridgeport area was one of the meccas where people from all over the world would come. Each little neighborhood had its own flavor. As you tour that area today, you'll see numerous churches. I'm talking about, there might be within a 3-block area, 3 pretty good sized Roman Catholic churches. The Polish, the Lithuanian, the Irish, the Croatian, Italian, Bohemians. Each one of the different people that arrived banded together in their own neighborhood. They had their own little clubs. They had their own way of entertaining themselves. They had their own language. The universal was the English language. We all got along pretty well. And they all also had their own funeral homes. We were in this little building was about 21 feet across. We lived on the second floor. The basement and the first floor were the funeral homes. I never had a bedroom at that particular location. They built on some lean-to porches, which acted as, sitting rooms and where we slept. My mother and father had part of the dining room, and there were curtains that went across, and that was their bedroom. It was right next to the living room, and then the kitchen and the little place that was built for the bedroom. My sister and I each had sort of a section. Bridgeport was the home of many of the mayors of the city of Chicago, many of the church leaders, also the mafia leaders, union leaders. A lot of people came out of Bridgeport and went on to great heights, or depending on what your outlook was, to great depths. So we had a cross-section of everyone there. There were a lot of crazy people that we had to deal with. My father, I always said, was the worst businessman but the best funeral director that I had ever met. He really knew how to take care of people, but he didn't know how to manage people, didn't know how to manage his employees. So we were always overstaffed, and people never really liked to do what they were supposed to do. There were some great characters that worked there. Paul Walintis was one of the wonders. He was a big Lithuanian fellow that came back from World War II. And Paul had his own way of thinking about the world. Everything was either black or white. Everything was right and wrong. And the funeral directors were very particular about what they wore. The mourning clothes, the striped pants, the black coat, the stiff shirt, a Hamburg hat or a top hat, spats, gloves. They were well turned out. So I was 14 years old driving limousines and hearses and flower cars. I didn't have a driver's license, but I belonged to the chauffeurs union, and I was able to drive these different cars. One of the great stories about Paul was, in those times when we went to church, after the Mass, the Roman Catholic Church, the priest went and had breakfast, which could take anywhere from 5 minutes to a half an hour. And the whole funeral and everybody in it would wait for him. It was just common, that's the way it was. So I was, as I said, 14 years old driving the hearse, and I would go around and check out all the cars and see that they had their stickers and funeral signs and things. A guy came and went right up with his car next to the limousine and blew his horn like mad. So I went up to him and I said, "This is a funeral. You know, why don't you just turn around and go around it?" So he didn't say anything, he just gave me dirty look, and I walked away. After I got about 10 steps, he just laid on the horn again. So I went back and tried to explain to him again what was going on, and he didn't make any comment, and I left, and he did the same thing. Well, at that, Paul came out of the rectory, and he was all decked out in his undertaker suit, and I could see everybody looking at him, you know, how is Paul going to handle this? So Paul said to me, "What's going on here?" And I explained it to him. So he said, "I'll take care of that." So he walked over and he opened up the door and he stuck his head in the car and talked to the man and then closed the door very majestically and strolled over to the hearse. And the guy just sat there with his hands folded. And I said to Paul, "What did you say to calm him down and stop it, you know, not doing, blowing the horn?" He said, "I just explained to him, if he touched that fucking horn again, I'd pull it out and jam it up his ass." And so that was Paul. We began the streetcar, and he would sit there and he'd look around. He was like the white knight. And if someone would get in, you know, the great trick was then to pretend like you fall asleep next to a young lady, and you know, all of a sudden you got your head on her shoulder. Well, Paul would be sitting watching all of this, and if that ever happened, he'd stroll down the aisle, grab the guy by the back of his neck, throw him literally onto the floor of the streetcar and say, "All right, if you got to sleep, sleep here, but stay away from that woman." The guy would be completely stunned. Once we jumped on the streetcar, and there was a very pregnant girl getting in, and this young guy literally pushed her out of the way, jumped out of the streetcar, and stood in the back. So periodically we'd stand, the back was all open. The streetcar would go for two blocks. Well, I was standing here, and Paul was next to me, and this guy was standing next to Paul. And he didn't say a word. We waited until the streetcar got going for one block, and all of a sudden this arm goes, grabs the guy by the shirt, boom, threw him right off the streetcar. He just flew. He said, "That son of a bitch, did you see what he did to that pregnant woman? He'll never do that again." So Paul was, then he would all of a sudden decide to do something really crazy. So he would, one day he went out and he started vacuuming the sidewalk. So he's telling me about it. He said, "Yeah, I went out and vacuumed the sidewalk." I said, "Well, why did you do that, Paul?" He said, "Oh, just for the hell of it, see what people would say." He said, "Nobody said anything. They just said, well, good morning, Paul." As I'm vacuuming the sidewalk, he said, "They must really think I'm crazy." And I said, "Yeah, I think they do." And then once he waxed, there's a long slide that we used going down from the first floor to the second floor so we could take the caskets down this corridor. For some reason, he decided to wax it. So as soon as you hit it, your feet went out from underneath you. And so he was the first one to slide down, hit a door, broke it off the hinges, and slid across the floor in front of a bunch of people. Anyway, there was another guy there that his name was Snooks, and he and my father were always arguing about one thing or another. Snooks lived above the funeral home. We had moved to 79th and Loomis. It was a Sunday morning, I got a phone call. One of the neighbors said, "Matt Lamb?" I said, "Yes." I was, again, probably 16, 17. He said, "Is your dad there?" I said, "Yes, he is." He said, "Well, would you give him a message?" I said, "Sure, what is it?" He said, "Well, the funeral home at 31st Street is all open. Doors are open, all the lights are on, and there's nobody there, but painted on the front window says, fuck you, Mr. Lamb, I quit." So, signed Snooks. So I said to my father, you know, Snooks has left, and he painted on the front window. Fuck you, Mr. Lamb, I quit. He said, oh, we gotta get down there right away. So we drove down with great abandon, and here it was, and there's a crowd of people standing around looking at it. And I said, well, Dad, at least he called you Mister. So it was a different sort of a time. They had the icemen that would carry the ice up to the third floor, and you'd put a little sign in the window, 50, 75, 100 pounds. We would have a lot of families that had deaths, and they wouldn't have any electricity. They wouldn't have any furniture. So we had these big extension cords. We'd go to whoever had electricity on the block and say, well, there's been a death in so-and-so's family, and they're going to have a wake in their house. Can we use your electricity? They'd say, sure. So we hook up the extension cords and then light up the house where the wake was going to be, so the people wouldn't be embarrassed. We would take our furniture literally out of our house. We'd roll up we had some oriental carpets and some big old chairs and stuff, and we'd cart them over to the house and put them up, and then we'd have the wake there. And everybody wanted chairs. I mean, that was like the big status symbol. So when you met the family, they'd say, we need 12 dozen chairs. Well, you'd be in a place that's, you know, probably 60 feet by 40 feet. You know, and you couldn't say, well, what the hell are you gonna do with 12 dozen chairs? 144 chairs, there's room for about 20 in here at most. Then people are just, you know, sitting on top of each other. Oh, we gotta have 12 dozen. So that was the big status thing. And then they'd stay all night long. So the first woman that decided that she was gonna break this said to my father, Matt, at midnight, I want you to get up and tell everyone the wake is over. They should go home. So he said, well, I'll be glad to tell them, but I don't think they're gonna pay any attention to me. She said, I want you to tell them, midnight. So at midnight, my father gets up on top of a chair, and he said, Mrs. Murphy wants me to tell everyone that the wake is over. Everyone should go home, it's midnight, and the doors will open tomorrow at 8 o'clock in the morning for anyone that wants to come. He said, two old ladies were sitting there having tea. And one of them said in a big loud voice, this is the first time I've ever been kicked out of a wake. And at that, Mrs. Murphy got up on the chair that I was standing on and said, well, then you come back tomorrow, dearie, and we'll kick you out again. And so that was the beginning of part of the process of having the wakes going to the funeral homes. We had a lot of different people that we served. I was I would arrange funerals. I wasn't a funeral director at the time, but I was sort of the janitor. I would be cleaning up, and people would come in and say, oh, we want to arrange a funeral. And so I'd say, sure, whatever you want to do. It was very simple at that point. So my first encounter with the mafia was I was vacuuming up, and here comes three big cars out in front. And obviously, this was somebody different. So I looked out, and all these guys got out. They're all very well dressed, and open up, and they're deferring to this one guy. He walks in, and he announces that his father had died. He said, yep, he shot himself, cut his throat, and jumped out the window, and they tell me that the fall killed him. So he said, he's over at the such and such a hospital, and I want you to take care of the funeral. So I said, yes, sir. And so he proceeded to go through this whole thing and tell me about his father and what religion he was and what they wanted. And so I said, well, now, you know, we have to make some decisions. I said, fine. So we went through the flowers, and then we went to the casket, and he said, I don't want to see all this, just show me the best. This is the best. And I talked about the concrete vault. I don't want that. So we came back up, and he said, is that it? I said, yes. He said, well, you won't see me again, but somebody's going to be watching to make sure that everything that we've talked about was done right. I said, oh, don't worry, it will be done right. So he said, how much do I owe you? I said, well, I'm going to give you a complete statement. He said, I don't need a complete statement, just tell me how much I owe you. So I figured it all out that it was like almost $2,500, which was a lot of money, figuring that the average funeral was about $300 or $400. So I said, it's $2,500. So he turns to the guy and says, pay him, pay the kid. So the guy whips out a big thing of cash. And bum, 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 bum. There. So then I get up and start walking. I said, oh, just a minute, I will give you a receipt. And he came back and he said, you think I'm going to pay you twice? I said, no. He turned around and walked away. So the other great story with those people were, oh, a couple of them. One of them, three guys came in with their wives. And we had a big radiator. That's where we would make the funeral arrangements. So they're all sitting there, and I'm sitting on a chair with a little tiny desk in front of me and a phone. And they said, what church you want to go to? And they said, oh, my mother's going to such and such a church. It was Roman Catholic. So I called up to get the mass. And the priest, the assistant priest, said, oh, I just looked those people up there. They're not in the, they don't belong to the congregation, so we're not going to give them a mass. And this happened quite often. So I said, oh, okay. So I hung up and I said to the family, well, I just talked to Father and said, there must be some mistake. You don't belong to the church and they can't have a mass. And one of them says, I'm going to go over and kill that son of a bitch. I'm going to take him, I'm going to shoot him between the eyes and throw him out the fucking window. And the other two said, yes, we are going to. And they all get up and they charge out the door. And the wives are sitting there stunned. And they said to me, you know, Matt, they're going to kill the priest. I said, oh, no. He said, yes, they are. That's what they do. They're going to kill the priest for doing that to their mother. So I ran outside. Oh, maybe I made a mistake. Come on back in. I got a call. I got to talk. I said, this was guy, some guy. He was a curate. And I got to talk to the pastor. I said, so come on in. Said, oh, if that prick will get that son of a bitch. So in they come. They sit down. I went back and to a different room. And the same priest answers the phone. I said, I want to talk to the pastor. He's taking a nap. I said, he'll want to hear this. Get him up. I got to talk to him. It's a matter of life and death. He says this. So I just said, tell him it's a such and such family. So about 2-3 minutes, the priest gets on. And says, yes, Matt, what's this about? I said, such and such a woman died. The sons are here. And your assistant said they couldn't have a mass, and they were on their way over to kill him. He said, holy Christ, they would have killed him. He said, what the hell's wrong with that guy? He said, we'll have a mass. He said, just keep away from here. It will be three priests on the main altar and one priest on each side altar. All the lights will be on and we'll have the choir. And everything will be wonderful. Just don't let him come over. He said, they will kill the son of a bitch, as they said. So I said, fine. So I went back and I said, oh, there was some mistake. That was a priest that didn't know what he was doing, blah, blah, blah. So that was fine. So the third great story was the head of the whole group, the Don, came in, and his mother had died. And he had his whole entourage with him. And so we're talking about what we're going to do. And now we're talking at this point, there would be not unusual to have 50 flower cars with just packed with flowers. And there'd be 30 or 40 limousines and, you know, hundreds of cars. So I said to them, well, now, you know, we need to get all this livery. I think we better order it because I usually have to go to Milwaukee and everywhere to get all the stuff. And I said, you realize that in the Catholic cemeteries there is there's a strike going on, and everybody's union, so none of the union cars can go through the picket lines. But I belong to the union. I drive the hearse myself, and I get a special exemption. I can go through the picket line, so the hearse will be able to go through, but everybody else will have to be walking through. And so he said, that doesn't bother us. We're going to have honorary pallbearers, so don't worry about that. I said, fine. I said, I knew enough. If he says don't worry about it, I'm not going to worry about it. So it was an immense turnout, an immense funeral. And the honorary pallbearers were these eight enforcers, and they were in their own limousine. And so they had the regular pallbearers, and then they had the honorary pallbearers. So when we were over at church, the drivers were coming up to me and saying, Matt, the honorary pallbearers approached me and said, are you going to drive into the cemetery? And I said, no, I belong to the union. And I said, well, we would really like you to do that. And we'd like to see your driver's license. We want to know your name and where you live. And so, well, we don't want to give you that. Well, you'll either give it to us or we'll take it. And so they said to me, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to drive through the picket lines. And I would think that you'd want to too. You know, I think you're a lot better off dealing with a few pickets than with these guys, because they play for keeps. So everybody then decided that we had probably 100 union people there, that we're going to go in. We're going to go in. So anyway, the honorary pallbearers came and said, now all of the flower cars are going to go ahead and set all the flowers up. I said, yes, that's right. So as soon as we start, we will lead the parade of all the flower cars. And you hang back, give us about 15, 20 minutes. Yes, sir. So off they went. And when we got there, here they're standing on either side of the road. The pickets are all laying on the ground with their signs underneath them. And they hit all these flowers, and they're ushering everybody in. Dun, 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 dun. And so that was the strike. One other great, we were burying one of the enforcers, and all of his friends were coming. They were all going to be pallbearers. So they said to me, Matt, who's going to be there when you close the casket? I said, well, that's up to the family. I said, well, we've talked to the family, and it's only going to be us. You and said, is this one of those caskets that are sealed? I said, yes. I said, fine. So you make sure that this room is completely clear and only you are there and us. And there were eight of them, so I said, fine. And so everybody left, and they all came, gathered around the casket. So just before I closed the casket, they said, wait a minute, we all have something for George. And at that, they took out all these guns, and each one had two or three of them, and they put them in every place you could think in the casket, sealed it up, boom, and away it went. So he went well armed to the next world. The other interesting group were the gypsies. The gypsies were the English gypsies, and they're run by the king. The head of the gypsies was completely in charge of everything. And I was, and still am, an honorary gypsy. So they would only do business with me, and everything was about honor and about word. Nothing is in writing. This is the way they operate. They're very influential group, and they have a lot of money. They came from all over the country. So when somebody died, the whole family, wasn't unusual for 30 or 40 people to arrive on the scene, and they'd want, they have a three-night wake. They wanted to stay all night long. So as soon as they arrived, they would, the first thing was, we're going to have a three-night wake, and we're going to stay 24 hours. And I'd say, no, you're going to have a one-night wake, and you're going to leave by 10 o'clock at night. And then everybody'd scream, oh, no, we can't do that, no. And so after probably 20 minutes of haranguing, we get down to the point where we'd say, well, it's going to be a three-night wake, but they're going to be out by 1 o'clock in the morning. And no guns, no knives, and no fighting allowed in the funeral home. Bring everything out to the street. And then we would go through this whole arrangement, and probably took 2-3 hours. And there was great demonstrations, a lot of going on. When it was all over, it wasn't really up to the family. It was up to the king. And so, when everything was done, I would then characterize: this is what we're going to do. This is the casket. This is how much it costs. This. And now it's all set. And then I'd say, and the king would always be sitting in the back. Said, you understand that now? I understand it. You agree with it? I agree with it. Do I have your word on it in front of all these people? Do you have my word on it? Well, I'll shake hands on that. We'll shake hands on that. And he'd get up, shake hands. The deal is done. The deal's done. And away they'd go. So one time, everybody was drunk. So I'm at home, it's about 2:30 in the morning, the phone rang, and it's two of my men at the wake. And they said, everybody's still here. Most of them are drinking up a storm. It's 2:30, and they say they're gonna stay all night. So I said, put on so-and-so, who's the king. I said, your word is shit. From now on, everybody knows your word is shit. Hung the phone up. Rings right back in. My word isn't shit, my word isn't shit. I said, yes it is, your word is shit, and everybody's gonna know it. All the tribes are gonna know it, everyone's gonna know it. Your word isn't worth fiddler's fuck. Boom. Ring again, no, what can I do? I said, you can get everybody out of there. You can take care of my men, you can give them money, you can keep them quiet, you can clean the place, and you can get the hell out. And I won't tell anybody that your word isn't shit. boom. My guy said it just, you know, everybody, boom. The other time, somebody had died and a relative came, got all the money. He was like a nephew. And so we had made the deal. About 3 weeks later, the king called up and said, did so-and-so pay you? I said, no. That son of a bitch. He said, today is Monday. Sunday, I'll meet you at the funeral home at 10 a.m. sharp. So he's in California. We're going to go get him. I said, fine. So I never had to worry about collecting bills or anything because he made sure that everything was taken care of in the tribe. So 10 o'clock in the morning, car pulls up and there's five people in it. This one guy and four others. So they walk in, he's got a brown paper bag, and in it is the money. And it was a lot of money. I mean, about $2,100, which was a lot of money at that time. So he said, pay him. Counts it out. Then he says, out of my territory, 12 hours from now, or you're a dead man. You got 12 hours to get out of my territory. Never come back. And that's it. So these were the kinds of things that went on behind the scenes that were different, a lot of fun. The church at that point was very, I think, exclusionary. They had all these rules and regulations, and I had a Mexican family come in. They had eight kids. And what I would do would be, you know, none of them went to church, and there was always some impediment of having a mass, a lot of these immigrant people. So I'd put them in a car, and we'd drive from place to place trying to find a church. So we went over to Archbishop's, I can't remember his name right now, but he was quite a guy. And I was walking in, and the Archbishop was walking out. He said, what are you doing here, Matt? I said, oh, I've got Pedro here who's died, and his wife and his eight kids. And we're looking for a mass. I said, this is the fifth place we've been to. He said, why would you have to go to five places? I said, well, they won't give a mass because he didn't belong to the church. Said, come on in, we'll see about this. So then we went and we're sitting in his office. They're all sitting there. He says, well, now, did Pedro go to church every Sunday? And, oh, no, no, no. Well, did Pedro do his Easter duty? And nobody knew what the Easter duty was. What's the Easter? Well, you know, does he go to Mass on Easter and communion and confession? Oh, no, no, no. Were you married in the church? Married in the church. No, no. He says, did he ever murder anybody? I said, oh, no, oh, we never murdered anybody. We got to have a mass. We absolutely have to have a mass. So, you know, they were on their way out, and he said to me, Matt, forget about having them try to give me any sort of donation. They have nothing. So he said, we're going to have a real nice mass. I'll have some music, and everything will be taken care of. But that was the difference between somebody with real Christianity and some of these other idiots that, you know, they'd read a book and this is what it says and the hell with what the people are. So the other thing was with the babies. You'd go in, say, oh, you know, the baby's in heaven. And so, well, you know, they really want something. So why are you bothering me with that? You know, that's who you're supposed to be. Aren't you the priest? So it was a little disheartening then. I hope we don't go back to those times. The church is now having a very difficult time. It's lost its way with all of these things that are going on with pedophile priests and all of that. But I think in many ways, when I go back to 55 years ago, some of them have lost their way then with the arrogance of how they treated the people. But, you know, they got over it and it became strong, so it'll probably become strong again. We moved from Bridgeport to 79th and Loomis, and that was, we went from being pig shit Irish to like lace curtain Irish, and it was a big step, you know. Off we go. Again, it was a funeral home, and I keep harping on this. I didn't have a bedroom, so I slept either on a couch or on a Murphy bed. And to this day, when I can't sleep, I can get on a couch and I can go to sleep immediately because I go right back to my childhood. So, 79th and Loomis, we had a gang of guys. When I say gang, it has none of the connotations of what a gang is today. We called ourselves the Dirty Dozen, and probably the worst thing we did was beat each other up, break each other's arms or leg or whatever in some sort of crazy adventure. But we never got involved with people outside of our own little group. Of course, we loved to smoke and drink. At that point, you know, one of the gym trainer, he had a speaker's impediment. He was a short fella, but he was younger than we were. So he'd go into a bar and he'd put his book on the bar and say, give me a drink, give me a moke. Bartender would pull him a beer and give him a pack of cigarettes. He could hardly get up on the damn stool. But it was a much more casual society then when it came to all of those things. And we just had a very good time. Riding our bikes. We lived in the alleys, and there was a camaraderie about us. And there were the big guys and the little guys. And the big guys would beat the shit out of the little guys, but it was all in good fun. You know, they'd play dungeon, where the big guys would grab you all and put you down into a some sort of a sub-basement and everybody'd pee on you, or, you know. But you daresn't tell your parents any of this, because if you did, you'd either get the shit kicked out of you by your father, or you got grounded. So everything was just fine, you know, everything is great. I went to the Irish Christian Brothers school. Now, 1946, there was never discussion about anything. Your parents would say, you're going to do this, and you did it. So I graduated from grammar school. I hated school with a passion. I had a perceptual handicap, but I could, my father had a great statement, you better earn a lot of money, because you can't write, you can't read, and you better be able to hire a lot of people that could do both of those things for you. So, he said, I was educated by the Jesuits, so you're going to go to Ignatius. Ignatius was a rough school, high academic skill. So I went and I took the test. And I get back the letter, and I flunked royally. So yeah, I can't go to Ignatius. So my mother says, well, my brothers, who were all doctors, were all educated by the Augustinians. So I'll have Uncle Dick, who was a world-renowned, he did the first transplant in the world. He's honored in the Smithsonian Institute and all kinds of things. So I'll ask Uncle Dick to call the Augustinians and get you into Rita. So Dick calls, and the Augustinian said, fine, you know, send him down, we'll give him a test. So down we go, get the letter back. I flunked the test royally. I can't get into Rita. So now I'm going to go to Calumet, which is the public school. Everybody can get to Calumet. So my father said, well, wait a minute now. Leo High School is owned by Monsignor Shoebridge, and I know Monsignor Shoebridge, so let's go over and talk to him. So he calls up Shoebridge and said, I want to come over and talk to you about getting my son into your high school, Leo. So he said, oh, yes, come on over. So over we went. So he opens the door. My father and I are standing there, and so he says, ah, Mr. Lamb, and is this the dumb kid that can't get any school? My father says, yes, this is him. Come in. So in we go into the office. We sit down. He said, my father says, well, we tried to get into Ignatius. We took the test. He flunked, so he couldn't get in there. So then we went to Rita, and we took the test, and he couldn't get in there. He flunked the test. So now he's going to go to Calumet. And at that, the Monsignor jumps out of his chair and says, if he goes to Calumet, he'll lose his immortal soul. He can't go to Calumet. He grabs the phone and he calls up the principal of Leo High School, Brother McCarthy, commonly known as the Rooster. He says, Brother McCarthy, this is the Monsignor. He said, I have Mr. Lamb. He's the undertaker, don't you know? And he's got this dumb kid that can't get into any school. They wouldn't let him in Ignatius or Rita. And now he's here over at my rectory. And his father's a good man. He's the undertaker. But he's got a dumb kid that can't get in any school. And if he goes to Calumet, he's going to lose his immortal soul. So you have to take him into the school. So he listens. He says, hey, won't be any trouble. Will you be any trouble? I said, no, I won't be any trouble. I said, what? He said, what do you mean send him over and you give him a test? There'll be no tests. He can't pass any tests. Don't you understand what I'm saying? He's a dumb kid that doesn't know nothing. He won't cause you any trouble, and he can't pass a test. So you're going to take him in, you understand? All right, he'll be over. You go over there now, and he'll take you. No tests. So, boom, I get into Leo. 40 years later, they make me man of the year. So only in the United States can this happen. One of the few countries where the dumb kid can go in. And 40 years later, they make you man of the year. I told that story in front of 1,000 people. When I was made man of the year, I thought it was great. But anyway, I went on to, then I had to go to high school, I mean to the college. So we went to embalming school first to become an embalmer. That was 12 months, and that was, you know, just crazyville. And then I went to St. Joe in Rensselaer, Indiana. And I was there 1 year, but my father got sick, so I had to quit, come back and run the business. And then I went to Loyola University. I didn't have time because I was running the business to really get a formal education. So I looked at all of the different curriculums, different courses, and I picked all the management courses. So I had none of the core, but I took introduction to management, management, second management, advanced management, full management. It was supposed to be over a 4-year period, and I jammed all this into 1 year. So the head of the management department was Dr. whatever his name was, and he called me and he said, "You can't take all of these courses all at once. They're all prerequisites and you have no core." I said, "Oh, I know that, doctor." And I said, "You are such a wonderful, wonderful teacher. The first thing I wanted to do was to talk to you about reorganization of my business." I said, "I have a $5,000 grant that I'm going to have to give to, I want to turn fixed expenses into variable expenses. And I read some of your papers about fixed to variable. I said, you would be the one that I really like to have do this for me. And it would be a great benefit to me and to take advantage of all of your knowledge." And I said, "I've got to run this business and I don't have time to take all this core stuff. I only have 1 year, I got to get all this in. And if I don't, if you notice that all of these are classes that you teach, so there'll be a continuity all the way through." I said, "Well, that makes some sense." And so I hired him on the spot and I learned more about business from him than if I would have stayed in school for 10 years. I mean, we got together after class, he came out to the business, we looked at everything, we pulled it all apart and put it back together again. So, and a lot of it was by ear, because I don't get a lot from reading, at least I didn't at that point in time. So I've had mentors over a period of years, and those are the people that really have taught me everything I know about whatever I do know about. Great friends that were able to help me. Bill Bard owned the big shopping center directly across the street from the funeral home that we lived in, and I could never afford a new car. So I just had an old beat-up car. And Bill not only had the big shopping center, but he also had a car auction. So we're sitting in his office one day, and he said, "If you could have any kind of a car, what kind of a car would you want?" I said, "Oh, easy question, a Lincoln Continental, black." And this was 1960-something. So he said, "Well, let's go out and get one." I said, "Well, what do you mean, let's go out and get one? I can't afford that." He said, "Oh, don't worry about it." He said, "We'll go out to the auction, and I'll rent it to you." So out to the auction we went, and we looked all around, and found this fabulous Lincoln Continental that was coming up for auction. So he went and talked to the auctioneer. He said, "As long as I stand next to this Coke machine, we're in the auction. If I walk away from it, then we're out of it." And he said, I told him, you know, increments of $100. So anyway, we ended up with the car. So I said, "How much is this going to be?" He said, "Well, we're going to rent it to your business, which is owned by my father." And I said, "My father is not going to." He said, "Well, what does he give you any kind of a?" I said, "I could probably talk him into $100 a month if I could do that." He said, "Yeah, let's make it $50. $50 a month, and I'll build the company." $50 a month? I said, "Yes." It's okay. So from that time on, for the next 10 years, I had any kind of a new car I wanted, and Bill and I just had sort of fun with that. It was, I think, sort of his hobby. He had a yellow Cadillac with all the bells and whistles, looked like a big canary. And we're sitting there talking about things one day, and he says, "I got that fucking yellow car, it's just driving me crazy." He said, "I love it." He takes the keys, he throws them, "Take it! Hey, George, go over to Lamb's car and take the plates off his and put them on mine." He said, "I like your car," which was his car anyway. So I said, finally I said, "What the hell do you do with all these cars?" "I send them to Vegas. Hey, you know, we jack the price up and I get back all the money. Don't worry about the goddamn money." So then the other great friend was John Hildenbrand, Hildenbrand Industries. They had helped him out. They had a big division for hospitals, the Batesville casket. And a big luggage company. So John had a fleet of airplanes, and periodically, if I had a problem, I'd give him a call, he'd send a plane down, and we'd go in and sit around his office and discuss what was going on. Whenever we got through, he'd say, the plane will take you anywhere in the country that you want to go except Vegas. If you want to go to Vegas, I need a note from your wife." One time, we get on this plane, and had two engines coming back, and one of the engines went out. And so we limped back in, and then I got out the plane. I said, "I don't know if I want to ride on these goddamn planes." He said, "Luckily you had two." "Oh, don't worry about it, don't worry about it." He said, "I've got a brand new plane that you're going to take you." It was one of these big executive planes. I felt like Frank Sinatra. Took two people to fly it, and off we went back to Chicago. He had bought the hotel. Should we stop now? I want to go. He was a great mentor. And one of the things he taught me is to surround yourself with people that know a lot more about things than you do. And he said that was his strength. So I said, how will you find out about this? And he said, "Well, I bought the hotel because no one wanted to come to Batesville, Indiana. But I turned this hotel into the dream world for the traveling salesman. I have all the furniture in the hotel is from the hospitals. So they can lay in bed, they can move the bed any which way they want. And then they can bring their thing over and write on it. All the communication system, this was far ahead of the time, in one of the greatest restaurants. So all of the salespeople would make it a point, no matter where they were, if they could possibly stay, they'd stay in Batesville at this wonderful hotel. And then they'd come and see me and try to sell me things." And I said, "If I knew," and he grabbed them an ashtray, "and I knew that I could buy this ashtray, but the best price I could pay for it in the whole world was 2 cents. And if I knew that and I shopped it and I tried everything and it was 2 cents for this ashtray, and a man would come in to me and say, 'Well, Mr. Hildenbrand, I could sell you this ashtray for a penny.' I said, 'Do you think I'd jump on it and say, oh, will you just save me a penny?' I'd look at them and I'd say, You cheating son of a bitch. How can you charge me a penny for this ashtray? I can get it anywhere in the world for a half a cent. And you're charging me twice as much. And you go on and on and on and get the guy so. And finally I take the ashtray and throw it on the ground. And he throws the grass and break it all apart and say, get out of here. And the guy would get so mad. He'd tell me everything he knew about the ashtray, how he was able to get her for a penny. And I'd sit there and I'd soak it all up like a sponge. And so that was one of the great things that Hildenbrand taught me. Never let your ego get in the way with your common sense. People know a lot more about a lot of things than you do. And if you think you know everything, you don't know anything. So surround yourself with giants and you'll be safe. Surround yourself with pygmies and you'll feel big. So I always tried to get people that really knew a hell of a lot more about subjects than I did. And I was able to surround myself with giants. Therefore, I was able to take care of my own deficiencies. That, again, is why it's such a big difference when I'm now in the art world, where you have to do everything yourself. But now, for something completely different, before Dominic gets me onto serious subjects. We're talking about, you know, what to name things. One of the great stories that I love is about the dog. And the old dog says to the young dog, I'm going to teach you everything you want to know about the world. So he's walking along and here's a bone with a lot of meat on it. So he grabs it and he eats all the meat and he said, that's lesson number one. Walks along a little bit further and here comes a little poodle. And he jumps on and services the poodle and he said, that's number two. And then come across a Rolls Royce and he runs up and he pees all over the Rolls Royce. And he said, that's number three. That's all you have to know about the world. Ooh, dog says, what's all this about? What, I didn't learn anything. He said, oh yes, you did. If you can't eat it and you can't fuck it, piss at it. So I have taken that further. And I tell this to all my managers and my family. One of my mottos is, for most of the people in the world, if you can't eat it and you can't fuck it, it doesn't exist. So those are that's really the materialistic part of this world. Those are the things that drive people, especially the procreation thing. We have taken every human bodily function and put it under the microscope, and we've talked about it, we wrote about it, we have seminars about it, you know, how to best screw your girlfriend, the best food to eat in the world, the best car to drive, how to robe yourself. I often said, thought, I have an honorary doctorate degree from St. Thomas University, but if I had to earn that degree, what would my dissertation be? And I thought it should be the bowel movement. We haven't really taken that to its full extent of examination. You know, well, now, Dominic, how was your balls today? I mean, that's really not been a subject that we like to discuss. So it's open for a complete examination. And I mean, we could really develop this whole world of bowel movements. That gets me to the point of how I keep my sanity. I thought at one time it would be drinking, so I drank to, you know, like mad. And I found I got sick, I got fat, I could always remember the beginning of the party. I thought he had a great time until the end of the party. I never knew when the hell the party was over. And then after I got married, I have to say to my wife, give me a list of all those that I insulted. And I'd look at the list and say, holy Christ, how could I insult this many people? And she said, well, you know, it took that long before you passed out. So anyway, I decided that that wasn't really the way to go. I'd be long in my grave before I would, smoking at least five packs of cigarettes a day, drinking everything that's put in front of me and more. So then I had to come up with just outrageous things, because I was surrounded by death all the time and by complete chaos in people's lives. And if you really care about people, you really care about what's going on, especially when children die or, you know, your people are your parents' age or your wife's age, you can internalize it. And every day you're in this quandary. So I started thinking of just completely outrageous things. Just, I was blessed in my two careers to be by myself a lot of times, because when you're riding in a hearse for hours to a cemetery, you're all by yourself. When you're in the studio, you're all by yourself. So your mind has to go somewhere. So I would go just thinking about anything that could be the most outrageous thing. You know, what would be the most wonderful bowel movement in the world? Harry sits on top of the throne, and before it happens, there's a large report of the fart, and the stench fills the room. It would actually, you know, it would floor a goat, you know, and then go from there to there to there to there to there, you know, just crazy stuff. Or here we have a place called the Creamery, so you have the song, the cream of fucking re, the cream of fucking re, hi ho the Dario, the cream of fucking re, the creamery takes a wife, the creamery takes a wife, hi ho the Dario, the creamery takes a wife, the wife takes a creamery, the wife takes a creamery, hi ho the Dario, the wife takes a creamery. So your head is going around like that all the time, you know, and you're standing very still. Your outward appearance is of great decorum and stoic, but inside is all this crazy. And that's how I keep my sanity. So now for something completely different. So now we'll get back to the business part.
Well, we need to know a little bit more about your childhood, your early childhood, which are your earliest memories, about your family experiences, your brother, your sister, your parents, physical and emotional environment in which you were raised.
It was a very loving environment. The home. We all came from the same sort of a place where there was never discussion about anything. There was the authority figures. The family was as much the people that I ran around with as my own family. My father was working all the time, but we lived above the funeral home. So we were intimately involved with all parts of the of the business. And from earliest times I can remember, I was always working, shining brass, taking out the garbage, doing the floors. I was proverbially the the fly on the wall that was never regarded. So I could see from an insider standpoint what was going on around without being noticed. And that gave me a lot of my early inclinations as to how people react to certain things. As I said, the employee situation. Everybody would be very busy when my father would arrive on the scene. As soon as he left to go on a funeral, everybody sat down and started playing cards. And we had a big announcement board, which is made up of hundreds and hundreds of letters, where they put the names up. And at least once a week, if they see him walking across, they'd grab the board, the whole big box, and throw it up in the air, And then when he walked in, here would be five people picking up these different, oh, we dropped the box again, Mr. Lamb. It was all bullshit, you know? It was just, it was make do. And then I remember one embalming company came, and they told the embalmers they would give them 25 cents per bottle for every one of the bottles that they used, because there were, you know, two or three different companies that my father used to use. And so I would see them after he'd left opening the bottle and pouring the stuff down the drain for a nick for 25 cents. And so we would use three or four times the amount. Those bottles probably cost $2 at the time. The guy's getting 25 cents, my father's paying $2, and it's going down the drain. So these were early business thoughts that I had. It was just a typical house. We didn't have a lot of money. I was never able to get a new bike. The thing that I really craved after was to have a radio on my bike. I never did get a radio on my bike. And I never did get a new bike. But it didn't bother me. It just, when I think back about it, and then just as far as eating is concerned, we had a certain pattern, and we had little lamb chops, and everybody got two. Well, to this day, when I buy little lamb chops, I buy myself eight. And I will, maybe I'm not able to eat all of them, so it gives me great pleasure to throw the rest of them to the birds, and but to know that I have eight if I want them. That's a throwback. And, talk about baked apples, you know. I'd love to have two baked apples, because the regiment was one. And but then we'd sit in front of the radio, and we'd listen to all these different great One Man's Wife, and I Love a Mystery, and all these, The Shadow Knows, and all of these programs. And it really was getting your imagination going, because you could imagine all these things going on. And we as a family would sit around and listen to all this stuff. We wouldn't discuss it. I never remember discussions going on, because there was the authority, it's the way it is, and then there was, you know, the rest. So any discussion went on outside of the house. That's why I actively all my life have found discussion and stimulation. I mean, I go and look for it. I look for people that really know what they're doing, know how to do it. When I first went, well, I'm now leaping ahead. Let's go back to as a child. I never would.
What's your very first memory?
My first memory was of not being able to do the schoolwork. And they found that I couldn't see the, after a couple of years, I couldn't see the boards. So I got glasses. And it never bothered me. I didn't really give a shit whether I did it or not. It wasn't a big priority to me to get an A, or, you know, to be loved in school or any of that kind of crap. It was something to be put up with and something to be tolerated. And I took no great offense to it, and I took no great pleasure to it. The pomp and ceremony of the church was very interesting to me. I loved the incense and the music, the flickering of the lights, all of the different candles, and the different collages, things coming in at me. I can remember making my first communion and putting on that white suit and having the little white prayer book with the plastic cover, and you know, I felt like King Tut. But then, as was the way of the streets, you know, I went out to show myself, and they beat the shit out of me and took mud. I never forget that, and just put mud all over my suit. And but that, if you were different, it was not to be tolerated, you know, with the kids. So being all dressed up in that suit with that white shirt and that white tie and all of that, I made myself into a target. So that was one of the first memories, is don't make yourself into a target, even as a little kid. Because if you do, you know, you're going to get shit thrown at you. So my parents were great public relations people, especially my mother. My mother was a person that was constantly going to the daughters, the D of I, the Daughters of Isabella, or the women's clubs. And she was very artistic, arranging flowers, and did a lot of organization. She was a great organizer. People would flock around her, and she was a great manipulator of the scene. And I learned a lot watching her. And nothing was as it was portrayed to be, which was an interesting situation. She always got her way, but it was never straight on. It was always sort of in a circular manner. But if you watched, and I did as a kid, you'd always see where she was going, and she always ended up there. So that was an interesting concept for me to observe. Again, as I say, I observed people. I observed the mighty. We had some really bizarre leadership. There was one old priest who was the pastor, and he used to get great pleasure out of throwing pennies out the window and watch all the kids beat the shit out of each other trying to grab them. And so to be in this crowd trying to get a penny, and a penny was a lot of money, and the old priest egging everybody on from the window. And this was, you know, I was in first grade. I remember that. The deliveries of different things and how people helped each other or didn't help each other. I always seem to be looking for the human aspects of the human condition, and of somewhat of the how people react differently to the same situation. It seemed to always, even as a young kid, fascinate me.
You're a pretty soft person inside who has hardened over the years?
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. I look at myself as being very Pollyanna, but with lots and lots of scars. Because I think it's difficult for people to be fair, because when the decision becomes me and something else, 99 out of 100 times it's going to be me. The whole world is going to end if you press that button, but if you don't press that button, you're going to be given this great suit of clothes and this great meal. And maybe the world won't end if you press the button, but maybe it will. So, but I think maybe I'll take this suit of clothes and the meal, take my chances. I'm afraid that many of the decisions in the world are made, especially by the powerful, because I've seen the powerful, and I've been in the powerful all my life, rarely make a decision based upon what should really be, the reality of what the decision should be based on. I saw that as a kid, and I've seen it throughout my whole life. But I still, you know, I'm still looking at the half full glass and not the half empty glass. And it's like the old story about the kid in the pile of shit saying, oh, there must be a pony in here somewhere. I'm always looking for that pony. And I find it periodically.
What was the relationship like with your brother and sister in China?
Well, my sister was older. She was 5 years older. She had her own life, her own friends. And, of course, the difference between a boy and a girl. I had my friends, and, you know, never the twain would meet. We got along fine because, you know, we loved each other, we talked to each other, we never fought because there was never anything to fight about. My brother was younger. He was 8 years younger than I am. And he had rheumatic fever 8 or 10 times. So he was very sickly most of his early life. And so he was, you know, always under care. And he had my sister and brother, I think, had a completely different upbringing than I did. I was brought up on the streets, and I'm street smart. My brother, because of his illness, is the academic. He thought through problems. He works in a completely different way. The funny part about that is when we were in business together, we both came to the same conclusion, but in completely different ways. I came from a standpoint of the streets. He came to the same conclusion from the standpoint of the academic world. But we always arrived at the same place. We never argued about it. You know, we had a more or less of an unwritten, if we ever argued and came to the conclusion that we could not resolve our differences, then we'd walk away. The hell with it. Because we saw so many families destroy themselves in death over nothing, over a little bit of furniture, some shit somebody left, a few dollars or whatever. And families would just go crazy over that little bit of nothing. We just thought there isn't anything in the world that's worth arguing and worrying about that's going to get in the way with our friendship and our being brothers. In the same way with my sister. I mean, we just would not allow that to happen. My father died second. So when he died, my brother said, I don't want anything. Nothing. And I said, I want his teapot, because that's what I remembered him. So I took a teapot, my brother took nothing, and that was it. I mean, outside of the money, there was, you know, splitting over the money, but arguing over, you know, this chair or something, television sets and all that crap. We said to anyone, and the family, it's all there, go take it. And we don't care who takes it or what they do with it. First the family and then the employees, and that was that. But that was really because of our looking at the relationships of families that got destroyed over nothing. So our relationships are very important. And one of the reasons, I think, is we know we're going to die. We're one of the few families that know we're going to die. Most people don't think they're going to die. So we know we're here and we're going to be gone. We're born and we die, and what happens in the middle. How we keep our relationships is very important to me. And so that that's how we try to build relationships within the family. With our children, my mother and father, I always felt, were just too busy. And that's one of the big regrets I have in my family. I didn't learn that in my own family until it was too late. I was too busy building businesses to pay attention to my children. My wife raised the children. And I meet them now as adults, you know, meet them 25 years ago or whatever. My oldest is 46. But I regret that. That's the only regret that I have, I think, in my whole life, outside of my drinking time. And I love that. But that is important. I think really the only thing you have is your family and friends. The only thing you really have is your reputation. And not the reputation that's set by the world, the reputation that you really know who you are. I happen to think that when we die, I'm a Roman Catholic, so I believe in a particular judgment, that I'm going to sit down with God and, you know, it's going to be like this. And he's going to say, here's how you are. This is how the universe looks at you. And everything's going to fall from your eyes, and you're going to see yourself really as the universe sees you, really as you are. And you say, holy shit, what a bastard. God's going to say, I made you, you made this. This is the one that you're going to live with in all eternity. So I don't want to live with that son of a bitch. God's going to say, too bad. You made it. So heaven and hell, I think you make your own heaven, your own hell. That's probably completely outside of dogma. But so what? What is, I think we're making ourselves, the world, is a smorgasbord. I was born a white Roman Catholic Irish heritage from Chicago, male. There's a lot of baggage. But it didn't come in boxes. It came very distorted. But that's what I carry around with me. And then I make all of these decisions about becoming. I'll take some of this, I'll leave some of that, I'll take some of this. And constantly people are coming and influencing me, and I'm influencing them. So I'm constantly changing. So from earliest times I can remember, I'm constantly trying to become something. What? I don't know. I think the great unexplored space is not out there, it's right inside here. And we are constantly trying to find out who am I, where am I going, what am I doing, all of those kinds of things. That's what my art is about. That's the real discovery. But it comes from the genesis of my earliest childhood. I gave my mother cards and my father for Christmas and birthday, stuff like that. When I look at them, the same symbols, same star, same symbols. So they must be ingrained inside of me. They've been developed, you know, further, but the genesis of them came, and I can look back 64, 65, 66 years and see things that I drew as a child and I can almost pick those same things out of my paintings. So, does the childhood predetermine who the person is? I don't think so. But on the other hand, I think that we can be so wonderful and we can be so terrible. The thing that's bothered me really in my travels, and I went to Dachau, was how can somebody be Roman Catholic or Lutheran and spend 5 days a week throwing Jews into the oven and then go to Mass and Communion and kiss their kids and have a nice dinner and go for a walk in the park and can have a completely different situation? How can we as human beings be so different? It's the paradox to me. And that frightens me, because as I see history replaying itself, if we can demonize people, then it gives us license to kill them. And now that's what's going on around the world. The demonization of certain cultures and religions and peoples and all of that. We have to come to the great equalizer, which is love. Love conquers all. First hope, and then love. And that's what it was taught to me through the funeral business, because there was always the same story told family after family after family. I wish I would have done this. I wish I would have done that. I wish I would have done this.
Going back to your early childhood, the last question, did you have a favorite toy or game?
I like things like Lincoln Logs, bike. I rode a bike from as long as I can remember. I was always on a bicycle, and I always liked to do exercises, you know, and chinning bars and spinning around, and like the human fly. We'd be up on the fourth floor, and we'd get on the outside poles, and we'd, you know, work our way down. We could have been killed. I mean, it was crazy. Fire escapes underneath, with the hands coming down from the third floor, hand over hand. If you would have dropped, you'd drop into an abyss. Yeah, we thought nothing of it. It was just crazy. But I loved all that kind of stuff. And the bicycle was probably the most important item to me. And I was constantly pulling it apart and putting it back together again. My big goal was to have, you know, a new bike with a radio. I never achieved that goal.
Did you buy a big bike in the end when you had money and a radio?
Oh, I have about five of them. In fact, Ed Schwinn Bike, which is the biggest bike company in the United States, was on my board of directors of my company. So I knew about every bike that, you know, came out, and Ed would always be sure that I had the latest model. So we had bikes everywhere.
You were saying earlier that you very much enjoyed church and candles. And were you an altar boy after the business?
Or? Yes. Yeah, I was an altar boy, and we had some great times with that. One story was the whole family would come when you had benediction. Well, there was three of us, and we were in playing with the fire, because the priest had the incenser. And then we made this big fire in the chancel of the church. And we were supposed to come out at a certain point, and the priest, unbeknown to us, had given us the clue three times. Now, our whole family was in the audience because, you know, Matt's going to serve this great event. But my father and mother and brother and sister and aunt were all there. So at the third time, we didn't come out. He went over and he yelled, "Get out here!" And then he went back after the pulpit. Well, Sullivan and I grabbed our candles, which weren't lit, and Lee J. King grabbed this big golden cross, and we all ran for the door, and the top of the cross hit the top of the door, came down and hit him on the head, and he fell on. And ready? 1, 2, 3, 4? Okay.
So cross hitting the door.
Cross hit the door, fall down. We propped him up, and he stared at us. And so you go down 4 stations, and then you come across and come back. We went all the way to the back of the church, which was wrong. So the whole thing is over, and we're in the back of the church. People are coming out. Excuse me. My father came up to me and said, "Oh, you just did a great job." I enjoyed the pomp and ceremony of the church. I didn't enjoy the use of power. That's where I think I saw, as a child, most of the power corrupts absolutely. I think institutions exist, for many cases, for the institution to take care of the person that runs the institution, and not the institution taking care of whatever it's supposed to be. So whenever I got on the board, did I learn a lesson? Yes. Whenever I got on the board of directors of any organization or became the president of any organization, I had a whole group of people that I really trusted, outside consultants. I always had the same instructions. Look at every financial back for at least 5 years, I hope for 7 years, and read the minute of every meeting that took place and track what we're supposed to be doing. What we said we were going to do, what started out, read the charter of the organization, read what the organization is all about, what's its mission, what is the mission statement. Most cases I found what the organization was doing had nothing to do with what it said it was supposed to be doing. And in many cases were set up really to take care of first the top echelon, and then let it all flow through. But everybody rides in a Mercedes-Benz. Yeah, but there's poor people that aren't eating. The poor will always be with us. And so that's been something that I sort of riled against. And in my own little way, whenever I get involved, I would try to change. But the other thing I found over the period of years is any change that I made, within 3 years it would be eradicated. If it had to do with the deterioration of power on the top. And as soon as I was unmasked as someone that was going to tamper with power on the top, there was a whole cadre of people who tried to get rid of me. But I always knew that that was coming, so it didn't matter to me. I sort of made that that was part of the way I had to live. I just couldn't be a part of the sham. As long as everything that I thought I was doing, and I'm trying to do, was within the mission and the context of who and what we're supposed to do. So I was president of many, many organizations over a period of 40 years, and I met some great people, some really wonderful people. And I met a lot of swine and a lot of Lee's bags. But I always looked at my job as to eliminate the sleaze bags and get the good people moving up. And also, in the discussions, to talk about there is a battle going on between good and evil. There is such a thing as good and evil. There is the right way and there is the wrong way. And there is greed, and it isn't your money, it's their money. All those kinds of things. Because money, when it's easily absconded with, is absconded with. Therefore, you've got to have the, if not the reality, the facade of looking at having in place mechanisms to keep people from, why did you let me do that to myself? That's the old story of the little town where when the local AA chapter converted the last drunk, they had nothing else to do, so they all got drunk. So you've got to keep looking at all this stuff all the time. And it becomes redundant, maybe, but it's the way it is, and I like it. I loved it. What was the question?
What your favorite toy was? Anyway, I think we've covered charge of fairly well, and we've also already heard a lot of stories from your adolescence. Still, when the word adolescence comes up to mind, is there anything on your mind that jumps up on your mind? Or?
Well, I always liked crazy hats, and I always wore distinctive hats, big, long stocking caps, and made different things, and was part of the crowd. And they said I was the leader of the crowd, which I probably was. But on the other hand, it was we just didn't give a shit about a lot of stuff. I mean, the Sun Times was a Times, the newspaper was one of the big newspapers in Chicago, and they had a baseball league. And we were playing baseball out in front of a guy's house for all summer. And the next summer then we started playing again. And he owned a place called Auburn Glass Company. And these people had a lot of money. And the reason we played in front of their house, they had a big yard. And so he came out and he said, I will sponsor you people, you kids, if you don't play ball in front of our house. We said, oh, a sponsor, what does that mean? He said, well, I can get you uniforms, and balls, and bats, blah, blah, blah. Go up to the park. So, hey, this is great. So over we went, and we all got that uniform. It said, Auburn Glass Company, AUBURN Glass Company. So we put it on, and we all liked the Auburn Glass Company. And so somebody said, you know what? Let's take some of these letters off. And so we did, and then it said, A-Burn Ass Company. So we were known as the A-Burn Ass Company. So they wanted to know about it. So anyway, somebody decided that we were going to get into this league. And we couldn't play for shit, and we didn't care anything about it. We just fooled around. So we got into this league. Somebody filled out the forms, and about 4 weeks later, we got a message that we were number two in the league. We had never played a baseball game. But because of a happenstance, by forfeit, we won all these games. And now we're supposed to go down and play this big game in front of all these people. So, shit, let's go. So we go down. And here, you know, there's big guys, the A-Burn Glass Company kids come down. And Trainer is pitching. I didn't know where I was. We lost the game like 82-3. And I don't think we had three. But it was horrendous scores. It was so bad that the opposing team in the ninth inning laid on the field to embarrass us. If the ball went by, we thought that was the funniest thing we'd ever seen. You know, and everybody came to see the game. The guy from the Times, you know, he was living. And we just thought it was wonderful. So, everything was just sort of, that's the way it is.
So you were a big sports person?
Not really. No, I wasn't. I loved jujitsu and, you know, that kind of stuff. But I didn't like organized sports that much. Probably too much discipline. In fact, baseball is the greatest game in the United States. I have yet to go to my first baseball game. And I live in the shadow of Kaminsky Park. It's just, you know, it's like paint drying. And friends of mine own baseball teams. I had the owner's box and all this. And, come to the owner's box. That's like going to purgatory. I don't want to go to the owner's box. Listen, watch this stupid baseball game. if I wanted to watch something, now I'd watch that on TV. I like to watch football because they kick the shit out of each other. I like to watch Michael Jordan, just the way he moves, and the organization and that whole thing is amazing. But sports per se, we're number one. I mean, that's crazy. Who are we? Well, it's a guy from Mexico. We got a China, we're number one. We have this Argentine that can really hit the ball. And there's somebody else from Florida. And where's the guy from Chicago? He's selling the donuts in the shop. We're number one. It's all this crap, macho bullshit. But, it gets us through life. Better than doing that and going to beat the shit out of each other. So it gives us the opportunity to jump up and down in the stands like the old Roman Empire, and everybody comes out alive. But, I just think it's sort of bizarre. We're number 12.
Any other adolescent memories?
Oh, driving. To drive the cars. I learned on these big old limousines, Packards my grandfather had, LaSalles, Rolls Royces. My sense of direction was terrible. I never knew where the hell I was going. And I'm supposed to be, at funerals. So they'd give me the flower car, which was the lead. Because I was just a kid, I could hardly see off the goddamn wheel. And they wouldn't let me in with the families because everyone else was just driving the car. And I worked for everybody. And so first time I was on the limousine, they said, give me down 55th Street, and then you turn right. I gotta go. So I've got the flower car, everybody else is behind me. And you know that you're supposed to stop the traffic as you go by, so you go through stoplights. I was really a big shot. I'm driving a flower car. I can't see shit behind me because of all these flowers. I'm hogging the horn. And all of a sudden, here's Lake Michigan. What the hell is this? It's the lake. So I get out and I look. Where's the view? There's nobody there. So I turn around and go all the way back to the funeral home. And there's a guy vacuuming. What the hell are you doing here? I said, where's the funeral?
sister in. So I go back in the church. Now they're bringing the casket out of the church. The funeral director's bitch. You son of a bitch. Where were you? Seven. I was at the lake. So I said, he was in the hearse. I said, you better ride in the flower car with me and show me how to go, or we're never going to get there. But that happened quite often. My father, I was at one of his funerals, and you go down, there's nothing to it now, listen to me, kid. You go down Archer, and you just stay right on Archer, and on your left will be Resurrection Cemetery. Now, we're, the church is on Archer. See Archer? It says Archer on the sign. Archer? Follow Archer. I can follow Archer. Get in the car. That's about 2 hours. Where the fuck am I? And I pull into a gas station. I said, I'm looking for Resurrection Cemetery. I said, well, where is Resurrection Cemetery? He said, well, it's in Chicago. He said, oh, Chicago is 45 minutes up this road. So zoom, boom, boom. I get there, my father's there. Where are you? Here, the grave is already filled in, the dirt's there, everybody's gone, my father's there. I wonder where the hell I am. So I said, well, I followed him. I thought it was an archer. You turn this way and this way, you know, about 5 miles after I got it. And I went to the right, and I should have gone to the left. But anyway, so then, when I got my funeral director's license, now I'm the director. I know everything. Got my striped pants and my black coat, my hat. I didn't know how to get anywhere. So still, this is 5-6 years later. So Archie Simpson, who had been a driver forever and was dumber than I was, they put two of us on a funeral going up to Helen. So I'm on the hearse, I'm on the limousine, and Archie's on the hearse because I knew damn well I could never find the funeral, the cemetery. I said, Archie, you know where this cemetery is? Don't worry, my boy, I know exactly where it is. I was there 2 weeks ago, so thank God, because I had no idea where this is. And I'm giving the service, I'm saying all the prayers and everything. I'm driving the car and directing the funeral, so I'm a one-man band with Archie Simpson, driving the hearse. So off we go, I'm driving the family, thinking about talking, having a big, you know, good time. The guy sitting next to me. So he said, Matt, do you know where the cemetery is? I said, I don't have any idea, but Archie does. He's driving there. He said, well, you know, we're in Wisconsin. We're only 12 miles from Milwaukee. I said, no, I didn't see. He said, didn't you see the sign? I said, no. So I stopped. Bought the horn. Archie. So he said, oh, I don't know where to go. So some guy comes up that's in the funeral. And he said, you guys know where you go? We don't have a clue. He said, well, I live out this way. And Joe was my friend that came to the funeral. He said, you follow me. He said, we've gone about 45 minutes out of the way. I'm getting so we followed this guy. So, you know, that was some of my funeral directors. But then I started going and finding the roots myself. So my father said, well, you know how much gas you're burning up doing it twice. I said, yeah, well, what do you want me to do? Keep getting lost? He was a real taskmaster. I learned a lot from him. He knew what he wanted, and he said it, and he either did it or he didn't do it. And there was no quarter given whatsoever. When I bought the business from him, the delivery business always carried the funeral business. I mean, we never had any money. Everybody was always pulling the devil by the tail trying to pay the goddamn bills. So I had paid full price, my brother and I, to buy the business. And, oh, the business now is ours. Open up the books, there's no money. We had used all of our own money, any money we could buy, borrow, and steal. And I said to my father, there's supposed to be a $25,000 receivable from land livery. He said, well, I'm land livery because he kept livery. So he said, I paid myself before I sold it, paid that off. So, well, how are we going to operate the business? Well, that's not my problem. And he said, that's your problem, it's your company. You have to do what you got to do. So, I went to the banks and went everywhere. They said, there's no more credit. So I said, what the fuck am I going to do now? So, luckily I have great friends. I was telling a friend of mine, he's pretty grimy, and he's the guy that sent me that crazy note about the village idiot's missing, please come home. So I was telling Ray, and he says, how much money do you need? I said, I need 50 grand, maybe 25, and then another 25 for all the kinds of stuff that we had going. He said, boy, that's a lot of money. I said, yeah, it is. So about 2 hours later, he walks in and drops 50 grand on my desk. Pay me back when you get around to it. I'll never forget that. Saved my ass. And those are the kind of people that you'll always remember. So, that's the way it goes. We were under distress a lot of times. The industry had decided to do certain things which I thought were not kosher, it was exclusionary, and they were going to pass certain laws, and I opposed them, and they tried to pass the law that would have literally put us out of business. But there's a lot of those things that were very traumatic. I was sued by the federal government for $36 million. Saving the loan situation. One of the mayors of the city of Chicago came after us and tried to close us down because we were on the political side. So we've had some, Washington, D.C., but always I had good friends that were able to rally around, and those are all stories within themselves. I mean, they're long. In fact, my lawyers have told me, if you ever write a book, you got to pass it by us, because there's a lot of things that went on, all of those things that are very, very traumatic, but very true. And it was the culture of the time. I've been through the valley of the shadow of death when it comes to all those kinds of wars. When you've done battle with people that make their own rules, write their own laws, buy ink by the barrel, and you still come out alive, then you've done yourself all right. There's nothing that can happen to me as a person, materially, that I haven't gone through. So I just don't give a shit. I mean, my focus now is on the spiritual, and there's no one that can hurt me, because I've been through it all. And it's all part of my story. I wouldn't want to live through it again, and during the time I lived through it, it was very, very traumatic, very stressful. But luckily, my faith in my spirit, in my God, and my friends, I've gotten it through in my family. And my wife is the steady part. I'd be lying in my grave without her. She's the one that keeps the rudder going. Zip.
Welcome to the SMKT, Matt Lamb Center for the Arts. Our mission is to promote the mission of peace, tolerance, understanding, hope, and love among people from all over the world. To improve communication among them, awakening in them the interest of arts through lectures, workshops, and scholarships. I hope you're going to enjoy your time here. It's an interesting spot. I love the setting, this old house that has literally hundreds of years of history dedicated to the arts, and now you're part of that history. Thanks for coming. Welcome. Welcome to the map. Welcome to the Matt Lamb SMKT Institute for the Arts. Our mission is to promote the message of peace, tolerance, understanding, hope, and love among people from all over the world. To improve communication among them, awakening their interest in the arts through lectures, workshops, and scholarships. Thanks for coming. Glad to have you here. Welcome to the SMKT Matt Lamb Center Institute for the Arts. Our mission is to promote the message of peace, tolerance, understanding, hope, and love among people from all over the world, to improve communication among them, awakening their interest in the arts through lectures, workshops, scholarships. Glad you're here and hope you have a fine time. Welcome, children, to the SMKT, Matt Lamb Center's Institute for the Arts. Our mission today is to promote the message of peace, tolerance, understanding, hope, and love through people from all over the world, especially the children, to improve communication among them, awakening their interest in the arts through lectures, workshops, and scholarships. You children are the carriers of the message. Every day I have to get up and find my child within me. So here's a special look at Matt Lamb the artist. There's my child. Hello, have a fun. And Winnie! Yeah! And you'll have a great day. Remember, a horse never has a headache. Have fun. Bye-bye. You children are the messengers of the world. Every day I have to find my child within me. So here's a special little present for you from the painter. And remember, a horse never has a headache. Winnie! That's the thing that keeps me in my child. Never lose it. Bye-bye, and welcome. Away we go. La-ta-ra-ta-ta.